Recorded Books and RB Digital present The Unsettling of America, Culture and Agriculture by Wendell Berry. Narrated by Nick Offerman.
The Unsettling of America, Culture and Agriculture by Wendell Berry. For Maurice Talleen. Preface. This book was meant to be a criticism of what I have called modern or orthodox agriculture. As I now realize, it is more a review than a criticism. Criticism requires a subject that is finished. When agriculture is finished, no would-be critic will be available. I am therefore constrained to accept my demotion as a privilege. Nevertheless, there is a difficulty in writing a book on so inherently topical a subject as agricultural policy, and this difficulty is time. Events that were the immediate cause of the book may be finished before the writing is. No reader of this book can fail to observe that it deals at length with the assumptions and policies of former Secretary of Agriculture Earl L. Butts, though Mr. Butts and the administration he served are now out of office. I can only insist that my book is not for that reason out of date. Secretary Butts's tenure in the Department of Agriculture and even his influence are matters far more transient than the power and the values of those whose interests he represented. Moreover, the cultural issues that I attempt to deal with have been with us since our history began, and barring miracle or catastrophe, they will be with us for a long time to come. As a matter of fact, this book's origins go back farther than the secretaryship of Mr. Butts. The first notes I made for it were incited by a news story in the summer of 1967 on the report of President Johnson's Special Commission on Federal Food and Fiber Policies. The commission said, according to an article in the Louisville Courier-Journal, that the country's biggest farm problem was a surplus of farmers. Quote, "The technological advances in agriculture have so greatly reduced the need for manpower that too many people are trying to live on a national farm income wholly inadequate for them." Close quote. The proposed solutions were to find, quote, "better opportunities for the farm people, a more comprehensive national employment policy, retraining programs, improved general educational facilities," close quote, etc. Both the commission and the writer of the article had obviously taken for granted that the lives and communities of small farmers then still on the farm and those of the 25 million who had left the farm since 1940, were of less value than technological advances in agriculture. There seemed also to be no official doubt that adequate solutions were to be found in government-supplied opportunities, facilities, and programs. Reading that article, I realized that my values were not only out of fashion, but under powerful attack. I saw that I was a member of a threatened minority. That is what set me off. Wendell Berry. Preface to the Second Edition. When I was working on this book from 1974 to 1977, the long agricultural decline that it deals with was momentarily disguised as a boom. The big farmers were getting bigger with the help of inflated land prices and borrowed money, and the foreign demand for American farm products was strong. So from the official point of view, the situation looked good. The big were supposed to get bigger. Foreigners were supposed to be in need of our products. The official point of view, foreshortened as usual by statistics, superstitious theory, and wishful prediction, was utterly complacent. Then Secretary of Agriculture Earl L. Butz issued the most optimistic, the most widely obeyed, and the worst advice ever given to farmers, that they should plow fence row to fence row. That the situation was not good for farms or farmers or rural communities or nature or the general public was even then evident to any experienced observer who would turn aside from the preconceptions of agribusiness and look at the marks of deterioration that were plainly visible. And now, almost a decade later, it is evident to everyone that, at least for farmers in rural communities, the situation is catastrophic. Farmers are losing their farms. Some are killing themselves. Some, in the madness of despair, are killing other people. And rural economy and rural life are gravely stricken. The agricultural economists chart the liquidation of assets, the shakeouts, and the downturns, apparently amazed that now even the large progressive and efficient farmers are in trouble. But this is not just a financial crisis for country people. Critical questions are being asked of our whole society. Are we or are we not going to take proper care of our land, our country? And do we or do we not believe in a democratic distribution of usable property? At present, these questions are being answered in the negative. Our soil erosion rates are worse now than during the years of the Dust Bowl. In the arid lands of the West, we are overusing and wasting the supplies of water. Toxic pollution from agricultural chemicals is a growing problem. We are closer every day to the final destruction of private ownership, not only of small family farms, but of small usable properties of all kinds. Every problem I dealt with in this book, in fact, has grown worse since the book was written. The one improvement has been in public concern about the problems. Among farmers, there is growing distrust of the agribusiness line of talk and growing interest in agricultural health and sanity. Among city people, there is a growing awareness that sane and healthy agriculture requires an informed urban constituency. There is hope in these developments and in the continued existence of a remnant of excellent small farms and farmers. Some prominent agricultural economists are still finding it possible to pretend that the only issues involved are economic, but that possibility is diminishing. I recently attended a meeting at which an agricultural economist argued that there is no essential difference between owning and renting a farm. A farmer stood up in the audience and replied, "Professor, I don't think our ancestors came to America in order to rent a farm." Enough said. Wendell Berry. March 1986. Acknowledgments. Anything that I will ever have to say on the subject of agriculture can be little more than a continuation of talk begun in childhood with my father and with my late friend Owen Flood. Their conversation, first listened to and then joined, was my first and longest and finest instruction. From them, before I knew I was being taught, I learned to think of the meanings, the responsibilities, and the pleasures of farming. But this book's greatest immediate debt is acknowledged in the dedication. Maury Tallien has been an indefatigable friend both to my book and to me. He has arranged indispensable meetings, written me letters, sent me clippings and books, talked to me on the phone, read my manuscript, borne up through hours of fervent conversation in his house, in my house, and over many hundreds of miles of happy agricultural travels. To his wife, Janine, I am indebted for understanding and for hospitality. I am, of course, hopelessly in debt to my own wife, Tanya, for keeping farm and household together during my absences, and for enduring both my travels and my travails. But she has also participated in the thinking out of this book, has been its critic, and finally, its typist. My neighbor, Tom Grissom, gave me invaluable help with the preliminary reading, and in many talks helped me to clarify my ideas. For reading the manuscript and other kindnesses, I am grateful to Robert Rodale, Jerry Goldstein, Sia and Ed McClanahan, James Baker Hall, Joan Hall, Gary Snyder, Jim and Barbara Foote, and my father. Stephen B. Brush, Clarence Van Sant, Gurney Norman, Ben Webb, and David Budbill generously gave me permission to quote from their letters, and Stephen Brush allowed me to make use of his excellent paper on Andean agriculture. For hospitality and other kindnesses on my travels, I thank Tommy Shoup, Everett Hildebrandt, Roger Blobaum, Mr. and Mrs. Elo Cusero, Mr. and Mrs. Mike Jessen, Mr. and Mrs. Monroe J. Miller, Arnold Hockett, Clarence Van Sant, Mr. and Mrs. John Heinrich, Patty Kaminsky. The list of my debts will make clear that much of the good of my book has been the gift of other people. Its flaws, on the other hand, have been furnished exclusively by me. Chapter 1. The Unsettling of America. Whoso hath his mind on taking, hath it no more on what he hath taken. Montaigne. So many goodly cities ransacked and razed, so many nations destroyed and made desolate, so many infinite millions of harmless people of all sexes, states, and ages, massacred, ravaged, and put to the sword, and the richest, the fairest, and the best part of the world, topsy-turvied, ruined, and defaced, for the traffic of pearls and pepper. Oh, mechanical victories! Oh, base conquest! Montaigne. One of the peculiarities of the white race's presence in America is how little intention has been applied to it. As a people, wherever we have been, we have never really intended to be. The continent is said to have been discovered by an Italian who was on his way to India. The earliest explorers were looking for gold, which was, after an early streak of luck in Mexico, always somewhere farther on. Conquests and foundings were incidental to this search, which did not and could not end until the continent was finally laid open in an orgy of gold-seeking in the middle of the last century. Once the unknown of geography was mapped, the industrial marketplace became the new frontier, and we continued with largely the same motives and with increasing haste and anxiety to displace ourselves, no longer with unity of direction like a migrant flock, but like the refugees from a broken anthill. In our own time, we have invaded foreign lands and the moon with the high-toned patriotism of the conquistadors, and with the same mixture of fantasy and avarice. That is too simply put. It is substantially true, however, as a description of the dominant tendency in American history. The temptation, once that has been said, is to ascend altogether into rhetoric and inveigh equally against all our forebears and all present holders of office. To be just, however, it is necessary to remember that there has been another tendency, the tendency to stay put, to say, no farther, this is the place. So far, this has been the weaker tendency, less glamorous, certainly less successful. It is also the older of these tendencies, having been the dominant one among the Indians. The Indians did, of course, experience movements of population, but in general, their relation to place was based upon old usage and association, upon inherited memory, tradition, veneration. The land was their homeland. The first and greatest American Revolution, which has never been superseded, was the coming of people who did not look upon the land as a homeland. But there were always those among the newcomers who saw that they had come to a good place and who saw its domestic possibilities. Very early, for instance, there were men who wished to establish agricultural settlements rather than quest for gold or exploit the Indian trade. Later, we know that every advance of the frontier left behind families and communities who intended to remain and prosper where they were. But we know also that these intentions have been almost systematically overthrown. Generation after generation, those who intended to remain and prosper where they were have been dispossessed and driven out, or subverted and exploited where they were, by those who were carrying out some version of the search for El Dorado. Time after time, in place after place, these conquerors have fragmented and demolished traditional communities, the beginnings of domestic cultures. They have always said that what they destroyed was outdated, provincial, and contemptible. And with alarming frequency, they have been believed and trusted by their victims, especially when their victims were other white people. If there is any law that has been consistently operative in American history, it is that the members of any established people or group or community sooner or later become redskins. That is, they become the designated victims of an utterly ruthless, officially sanctioned, and subsidized exploitation. The colonists who drove off the Indians came to be intolerably exploited by their imperial governments, and that alien imperialism was thrown off, only to be succeeded by a domestic version of the same thing. The class of independent small farmers who fought the War of Independence has been exploited by and recruited into the industrial society, until by now it is almost extinct. Today, the most numerous heirs of the farmers of Lexington and Concord are the little groups scattered all over the country whose names begin with save. Save our land. Save the valley. Save our mountains. Save our streams. Save our farmland. As so often before, these are designated victims. People without official sanction, often without official friends, who are struggling to preserve their places, their values, and their lives as they know them and prefer to live them against the agencies of their own government, which are using their own tax monies against them. The only escape from this destiny of victimization has been to succeed, that is, to make it into the class of exploiters, and then to remain so specialized and so mobile as to be unconscious of the effects of one's life or livelihood. This escape is, of course, illusory. For one man's producer is another's consumer. And even the richest and most mobile will soon find it hard to escape the noxious effluence and fumes of their various public services. Let me emphasize that I am not talking about an evil that is merely contemporary or modern, but one that is as old in America as the white man's presence here. It is an intention that was organized here almost from the start. The New World, Bernard DeVoto wrote in The Course of Empire, was a constantly expanding market. Its value in gold was enormous, but it had still greater value in that it expanded and integrated the industrial systems of Europe. And he continues, "The first belt knife given by a European to an Indian was a portent as great as the cloud that mushroomed over Hiroshima. Instantly, the man of 6,000 BC was bound fast to a way of life that had developed 7.5 millennia beyond his own. He began to live better, and he began to die." The principal European trade goods were tools, cloth, weapons, ornaments, novelties, and alcohol. The sudden availability of these things produced a revolution that affected every aspect of Indian life. The struggle for existence became easier. Immemorial handicrafts grew obsolescent, then obsolete. Methods of hunting were transformed. So were methods and the purposes of war. As war became deadlier in purpose and armament, a surplus of women developed, so that marriage customs changed and polygamy became common. The increased usefulness of women in the preparation of pelts worked to the same end. Standards of wealth, prestige, and honor changed. The Indians acquired commercial values and developed business cults. They became more mobile. DeVoto goes on, "In the sum, it was cataclysmic. A culture was forced to change much faster than change could be adjusted to. All corruptions of culture produce breakdowns of morale, of communal integrity, and of personality. And this force was as strong as any other in the white man's subjugation of the red man." I have quoted these sentences from DeVoto because, the obvious differences aside, he is so clearly describing a revolution that did not stop with the subjugation of the Indians, but went on to impose substantially the same catastrophe upon the small farms and the farm communities, upon the shops of small local tradesmen of all sorts, upon the workshops of independent craftsmen, and upon the households of citizens. It is a revolution that is still going on. The economy is still substantially that of the fur trade, still based on the same general kinds of commercial items: technology, weapons, ornaments, novelties, and drugs. The one great difference is that by now, the revolution has deprived the mass of consumers of any independent access to the staples of life: clothing, shelter, food, even water. Air remains the only necessity that the average user can still get for himself, and the revolution has imposed a heavy tax on that by way of pollution. Commercial conquest is far more thorough and final than military defeat. The Indian became a redskin, not by loss in battle, but by accepting a dependence on traders that made necessities of industrial goods. This is not merely history, it is a parable. DeVoto makes it clear that the imperial powers, having made themselves willing to impose this exploitive industrial economy upon the Indians, could not then keep it from contaminating their own best intentions. More than 4/5 of the wealth of New France was furs, the rest was fish, and it had no agricultural wealth. One trouble was that whereas the crown's imperial policy required it to develop the country's agriculture, the crown's economy required the colony's furs, an adverse interest. And LaSalle's dreams of developing Louisiana, agriculturally and otherwise, was frustrated because the interest of the court in Louisiana colonization was to secure a bridgehead for an attack on the silver mines of northern Mexico. One cannot help but see the similarity between this foreign colonialism and the domestic colonialism that, by policy, converts productive farm, forest, and grazing lands into strip mines. Now, as then, we see the abstract values of an industrial economy preying upon the native productivity of land and people. The fur trade was only the first establishment on this continent of a mentality whose triumph is its catastrophe. My purposes in beginning with this survey of history are, one, to show how deeply rooted in our past is the mentality of exploitation. Two, to show how fundamentally revolutionary it is. And three, to show how crucial to our history, hence to our own minds, is the question of how we will relate to our land. This question, now that the corporate revolution has so determinedly invaded the farmland, returns us to our oldest crisis. We can understand a great deal of our history, from Cortez's destruction of Tenochtitlan in 1521 to the bulldozer attack on the coal fields 4.5 centuries later, by thinking of ourselves as divided into conquerors and victims. In order to understand our own time and predicament and the work that is to be done, we would do well to shift the terms and say that we are divided between exploitation and nurture. The first set of terms is too simple for the purpose, because in any given situation, it proposes to divide people into two mutually exclusive groups. It becomes complicated only when we are dealing with situations in succession, as when a colonist who persecuted the Indians then resisted persecution by the crown. The terms exploitation and nurture, on the other hand, describe a division not only between persons but also within persons. We are all, to some extent, the products of an exploitive society, and it would be foolish and self-defeating to pretend that we do not bear its stamp. Let me outline as briefly as I can what seem to me the characteristics of these opposite kinds of mind. I conceive a strip miner to be a model exploiter, and as a model nurturer, I take the old-fashioned idea or ideal of a farmer. The exploiter is a specialist, an expert. The nurturer is not. The standard of the exploiter is efficiency. The standard of the nurturer is care. The exploiter's goal is money, profit. The nurturer's goal is health. His land's health, his own, his family's, his community's, his country's. Whereas the exploiter asks a piece of land only how much and how quickly it can be made to produce, the nurturer asks a question that is much more complex and difficult. What is its carrying capacity? That is, how much can be taken from it without diminishing it? What can it produce dependably for an indefinite time? The exploiter wishes to earn as much as possible by as little work as possible. The nurturer expects, certainly, to have a decent living from his work, but his characteristic wish is to work as well as possible. The competence of the exploiter is in organization. That of the nurturer is in order. A human order, that is, that accommodates itself both to other order and to mystery. The exploiter typically serves an institution or organization. The nurturer serves land, household, community, place. The exploiter thinks in terms of numbers, quantities, hard facts. The nurturer in terms of character, condition, quality, kind. It seems likely that all the movements of recent years have been representing various claims that nurture has to make against exploitation. The women's movement, for example, when its energies are most accurately placed, is arguing the case of nurture. Other times, it is arguing the right of women to be exploiters, which men have no right to be. The exploiter is clearly the prototype of the masculine man, the wheeler-dealer whose practical goals require the sacrifice of flesh, feeling, and principle. The nurturer, on the other hand, has always passed with ease across the boundaries of the so-called sexual roles. Of necessity and without apology, the preserver of seed, the planter, becomes midwife and nurse. Breeder is always metamorphosing into brooder and back again. Over and over again, spring after spring, the questing mind, idealist and visionary, must pass through the planting to become nurturer of the real. The farmer, sometimes known as husbandman, is by definition half-mother. The only question is how good a mother he or she is. And the land itself is not mother or father only, but both. Depending on crop and season, it is at one time receiver of seed, bearer and nurturer of young, at another, raiser of seed stock, bearer and shedder of seed. And in response to these changes, the farmer crosses back and forth from one zone of spousehood to another, first as planter, then as gatherer. Farmer and land are thus involved in a sort of dance in which the partners are always at opposite sexual poles, and the lead keeps changing. The farmer, as seed bearer, causes growth. The land, as seed bearer, causes the harvest. The exploitive always involves the abuse or the perversion of nurture, and ultimately its destruction. Thus, we saw how far the exploitive revolution had penetrated the official character when our recent Secretary of Agriculture remarked that food is a weapon. This was given a fearful symmetry indeed when, in discussing the possible use of nuclear weapons, a Secretary of Defense spoke of palatable levels of devastation. Consider the associations that have since ancient times clustered around the idea of food. Associations of mutual care, generosity, neighborliness, festivity, communal joy, religious ceremony. And you will see that these two secretaries represent a cultural catastrophe. The concerns of farming and those of war, once thought to be diametrically opposed, have become identical. Here we have an example of men who have been made vicious, not presumably by nature or circumstances, but by their values. Food is not a weapon. To use it as such, to foster a mentality willing to use it as such, is to prepare in the human character and community the destruction of the sources of food. The first casualties of the exploitive revolution are character and community. When those fundamental integrities are devalued and broken, then perhaps it is inevitable that food will be looked upon as a weapon, just as it is inevitable that the earth will be looked upon as fuel and people as numbers or machines. But character and community, that is, culture in the broadest, richest sense, constitute, just as much as nature, the source of food. Neither nature nor people alone can produce human sustenance, but only the two together, culturally wedded. The poet Edwin Muir said it unforgettably. Men are made of what is made. The meat, the drink, the life, the corn. Laid up by them, in them reborn. And self-begotten cycles close about our way. Indigenous art and simple spells make unafraid the haunted labyrinths of the heart. And with our wild succession, braid the resurrection of the rose. To think of food as a weapon, or of a weapon as food, may give an illusory security and wealth to a few, but it strikes directly at the life of all. The concept of food as weapon is not surprisingly the doctrine of a Department of Agriculture that is being used as an instrument of foreign political and economic speculation. This militarizing of food is the greatest threat so far raised against the farmland and the farm communities of this country. If present attitudes continue, we may expect government policies that will encourage the destruction by overuse of farmland. This, of course, has already begun. To answer the official call for more production, evidently to be used to bait or bribe foreign countries, farmers are plowing their waterways and permanent pastures. Lands that ought to remain in grass are being planted in row crops. Contour plowing, crop rotation, and other conservation measures seem to have gone out of favor or fashion in official circles and are practiced less and less on the farm. This exclusive emphasis on production will accelerate the mechanization and chemicalization of farming, increase the price of land, increase overhead and operating costs, and thereby further diminish the farm population. Thus, the tendency, if not the intention, of Mr. Butz's confusion of farming and war is to complete the deliverance of American agriculture into the hands of corporations. The cost of this corporate totalitarianism in energy, land, and social disruption will be enormous. It will lead to the exhaustion of farmland and farm culture. Husbandry will become an extractive industry. Because maintenance will entirely give way to production, the fertility of the soil will become a limited, unrenewable resource like coal or oil. This may not happen. It need not happen. But it is necessary to recognize that it can happen. That it can happen is made evident not only by the words of such men as Mr. Butz, but more clearly by the large-scale industrial destruction of farmland already in progress. If it does happen, we are familiar enough with the nature of American salesmanship to know that it will be done in the name of the starving millions, in the name of liberty, justice, democracy, and brotherhood, and to free the world from communism. We must, I think, be prepared to see and to stand by the truth, that the land should not be destroyed for any reason, not even for any apparently good reason. We must be prepared to say that enough food, year after year, is possible only for a limited number of people, and that this possibility can be preserved only by the steadfast, knowledgeable care of those people. Such crash programs, as apparently have been contemplated by the Department of Agriculture in recent years, will in the long run cause more starvation than they can remedy. Meanwhile, the dust clouds rise again over Texas and Oklahoma. Snert is falling in Kansas. Snowdrifts in Iowa and the Dakotas are black with blown soil. The fields lose their humus and porosity, become less retentive of water, depend more on pesticides, herbicides, chemical fertilizers. Bigger tractors become necessary because the compacted soils are harder to work, and their greater weight further compacts the soil. More and bigger machines, more chemical and methodological shortcuts are needed because of the shortage of manpower on the farm. And the problems of overcrowding and unemployment increase in the cities. It is estimated that it now costs, by erosion, 2 bushels of Iowa topsoil to grow 1 bushel of corn. It is variously estimated that from 5 to 12 calories of fossil fuel energy are required to produce 1 calorie of hybrid corn energy. An official of the National Farmers Union says that a farmer who earns $10,000 to $12,000 a year typically leaves an estate valued at about $320,000, which means that when that farm is financed again, either by a purchaser or by an heir to pay the inheritance taxes, it simply cannot support its new owner and pay for itself. And the progressive farmer predicts the disappearance of 200,000 to 400,000 farms each year during the next 20 years if the present trend continues. The first principle of the exploitive mind is to divide and conquer. And surely there has never been a people more ominously and painfully divided than we are, both against each other and within ourselves. Once the revolution of exploitation is underway, statesmanship and craftsmanship are gradually replaced by salesmanship, the craft of persuading people to buy what they do not need and do not want for more than it is worth. Its stock in trade and politics is to sell despotism and avarice as freedom and democracy. In business, it sells sham and frustration as luxury and satisfaction. The constantly expanding market, first opened in the New World by the fur traders, is still expanding, no longer so much by expansions of territory or population, but by the calculated outdating, outmoding, and degradation of goods, and by the hysterical self-dissatisfaction of consumers that is indigenous to an exploitive economy. This gluttonous enterprise of ugliness, waste, and fraud thrives in the disastrous breach it has helped to make between our bodies and our souls. As a people, we have lost sight of the profound communion, even the union, of the inner with the outer life. Confucius said, "If a man have not order within him, he cannot spread order about him." Surrounded as we are by evidence of the disorders of our souls and our world, we feel the strong truth in those words as well as the possibility of healing that is in them. We see the likelihood that our surroundings, from our clothes to our countryside, are the products of our inward life, our spirit, our vision, as much as they are products of nature and work. If this is true, then we cannot live as we do and be as we would like to be. There is nothing more absurd, to give an example that is only apparently trivial, than the millions who wish to live in luxury and idleness and yet be slender and good-looking. We have millions, too, whose livelihoods, amusements, and comforts are all destructive, who nevertheless wish to live in a healthy environment. They want to run their recreational engines in clean, fresh air. There is now, in fact, no benefit that is not associated with disaster. That is because power can be disposed morally or harmlessly only by thoroughly unified characters and communities. What caused these divisions? There are, no doubt, many causes, complex both in themselves and in their interaction. But pertinent to all of them, I think, is our attitude toward work. The growth of the exploiters' revolution on this continent has been accompanied by the growth of the idea that work is beneath human dignity, particularly any form of handwork. We have made it our overriding ambition to escape work, and as a consequence have debased work until it is only fit to escape from. We have debased the products of work, and have been, in turn, debased by them. Out of this contempt for work arose the idea of a nigger. At first, some person, and later something, to be used to relieve us of the burden of work. If we began by making niggers of people, we have ended by making a nigger of the world. We have taken the irreplaceable energies and materials of the world and turned them into gimcrack, labor-saving devices. We have made of the rivers and oceans and winds niggers to carry away our refuse, which we think we are too good to dispose of decently ourselves. And in doing this to the world that is our common heritage and bond, we have returned to making niggers of people. We have become each other's niggers. But is work something that we have a right to escape? And can we escape it with impunity? We are probably the first entire people ever to think so. All the ancient wisdom that has come down to us counsels otherwise. It tells us that work is necessary to us, as much a part of our condition as mortality. That good work is our salvation and our joy. That shoddy or dishonest or self-serving work is our curse and our doom. We have tried to escape the sweat and sorrow promised in Genesis, only to find that, in order to do so, we must forswear love and excellence, health and joy. Thus, we can see growing out of our history a condition that is physically dangerous, morally repugnant, ugly. Contrary to the blandishments of the salesman, it is not particularly comfortable or happy. It is not even affluent in any meaningful sense because its abundance is dependent on sources that are being rapidly exhausted by its methods. To see these things is to come up against the question, then what is desirable? One possibility is just to tag along with the fantasists in government and industry who would have us believe that we can pursue our ideals of affluence, comfort, mobility, and leisure indefinitely. This curious faith is predicated on the notion that we will soon develop unlimited new sources of energy, domestic oil fields, shale oil, gasified coal, nuclear power, solar energy, and so on. This is fantastical because the basic cause of the energy crisis is not scarcity. It is moral ignorance and weakness of character. We don't know how to use energy or what to use it for, and we cannot restrain ourselves. Our time is characterized as much by the abuse and waste of human energy as it is by the abuse and waste of fossil fuel energy. Nuclear power, if we are to believe its advocates, is presumably going to be well used by the same mentality that has egregiously devalued and misapplied man and woman power. If we had an unlimited supply of solar or wind power, we would use that destructively too, for the same reasons. Perhaps all of those sources of energy are going to be developed. Perhaps all of them can sooner or later be developed without threatening our survival. But not all of them together can guarantee our survival, and they cannot define what is desirable. We will not find those answers in Washington, D.C., or in the laboratories of oil companies. In order to find them, we will have to look closer to ourselves. I believe that the answers are to be found in our history, in its, until now, subordinate tendency of settlement, of domestic permanence. This was the ambition of thousands of immigrants. It is formulated eloquently in some of the letters of Thomas Jefferson. It was the dream of the freed slaves. It was written into law in the Homestead Act of 1862. There are few of us whose families have not at some time been moved to see its vision and to attempt to enact its possibility. I am talking about the idea that as many as possible should share in the ownership of the land and thus be bound to it by economic interest, by the investment of love and work, by family loyalty, by memory and tradition. How much land this should be is a question, and the answer will vary with geography. The Homestead Act said 160 acres. The freedmen of the 1860s hoped for 40. We know that, particularly in other countries, families have lived decently on far fewer acres than that. The old idea is still full of promise. It is potent with healing and with health. It has the power to turn each person away from the big-time promising and planning of the government to confront in himself, in the immediacy of his own circumstances and whereabouts, the question of what methods and what ways are best. It proposes an economy of necessities rather than an economy based upon anxiety, fantasy, luxury, and idle wishing. It proposes the independent, freestanding citizenry that Jefferson thought to be the surest safeguard of democratic liberty. And perhaps most important of all, it proposes an agriculture based upon intensive work, local energies, care, and long-living communities. That is, to state the matter from a consumer's point of view, a dependable, long-term food supply. This is a possibility that is obviously imperiled by antipathy in high places, by adverse public fashions and attitudes, by the deterioration of our present farm communities and traditions, by the flawed education and the inexperience of our young people. Yet it alone can promise us the continuity of attention and devotion, without which the human life of the earth is impossible. 60 years ago, in another time of crisis, Thomas Hardy wrote these stanzas. Only a man harrowing clods in a slow, silent walk, with an old horse that stumbles and nods, half asleep as they stalk. Only thin smoke without flame from the heaps of couch grass. Yet this will go onward the same, though dynasties pass. Today, most of our people are so conditioned that they do not wish to harrow clods either with an old horse or with a new tractor. Yet Hardy's vision has come to be more urgently true than ever. The great difference these 60 years have made is that, though we feel that this work must go onward, we are not so certain that it will. But the care of the earth is our most ancient and most worthy, and, after all, our most pleasing responsibility. To cherish what remains of it and to foster its renewal is our only legitimate hope. 1977. Chapter 2. The Ecological Crisis as a Crisis of Character. Wanting good government in their states, they first established order in their own families. Wanting order in the home, they first disciplined themselves. Confucius, The Great Digest. In July of 1975, it was revealed by William Rood in the Los Angeles Times that some of our largest and most respected conservation organizations owned stock in the very corporations and industries that have been notorious for their destructiveness and for their indifference to the concerns of conservationists. The Sierra Club, for example, had owned stocks and bonds in Exxon, General Motors, Tenneco, steel companies having the worst pollution records in the industry, Public Service Company of Colorado, strip mining firms with 53 leases covering nearly 180,000 acres, and pulp mill operators cited by environmentalists for their poor water pollution controls. These investments proved deeply embarrassing once they were made public, but the club's officers responded as quickly as possible by making appropriate changes in its investment policy. And so, if it were only a question of policy, these investments could be easily forgotten, dismissed as aberrations of the sort that inevitably turn up now and again in the workings of organizations. The difficulty is that, although the investments were absurd, they were not aberrant. They were perfectly representative of the modern character. These conservation groups were behaving with a very ordinary consistency. They were only doing as organizations what many of their members were and are doing as individuals. They were making convenience of enterprises that they knew to be morally and even practically indefensible. We are dealing, then, with an absurdity that is not a quirk or an accident, but is fundamental to our character as a people. The split between what we think and what we do is profound. It is not just possible, it is altogether to be expected, that our society would produce conservationists who invest in strip mining companies, just as it must inevitably produce asthmatic executives whose industries pollute the air and vice presidents of pesticide corporations whose children are dying of cancer. And these people will tell you that this is the way the real world works. They will pride themselves on their sacrifices for our standard of living. They will call themselves practical men and hard-headed realists, and they will have their justifications in abundance from intellectuals, college professors, clergymen, politicians. The viciousness of a mentality that can look complacently upon disease as part of the cost would be obvious to any child, but this is the realism of millions of modern adults. There is no use pretending that the contradiction between what we think or say and what we do is a limited phenomenon. There is no group of the extra intelligent or extra concerned or extra virtuous that is exempt. I cannot think of any American whom I know or have heard of who is not contributing in some way to destruction. The reason is simple. To live undestructively in an economy that is overwhelmingly destructive would require of any one of us, or of any small group of us, a great deal more work than we have yet been able to do. How could we divorce ourselves completely, and yet responsibly, from the technologies and powers that are destroying our planet? The answer is not yet thinkable, and it will not be thinkable for some time, even though there are now groups and families and persons everywhere in the country who have begun the labor of thinking it. And so we are by no means divided or readily divisible into environmental saints and sinners. But there are legitimate distinctions that need to be made. These are distinctions of degree and consciousness. Some people are less destructive than others, and some are more conscious of their destructiveness than others. For some, their involvement in pollution, soil depletion, strip mining, deforestation, industrial and commercial waste is simply a practical compromise. a necessary reality, the price of modern comfort and convenience. For others, this list of involvements is an agenda for thought and work that will produce remedies. People who thus set their lives against destruction have necessarily confronted in themselves the absurdity that they have recognized in their society. They have first observed the tendency of modern organizations to perform in opposition to their stated purposes. They have seen governments that exploit and oppress the people they are sworn to serve and protect, medical procedures that produce ill health, schools that preserve ignorance, methods of transportation that, as Ivan Illich says, have created more distances than they bridge. And they have seen that these public absurdities are, and can be, no more than the aggregate result of private absurdities. The corruption of community has its source in the corruption of character. This realization has become the typical moral crisis of our time. Once our personal connection to what is wrong becomes clear, then we have to choose. We can go on as before, recognizing our dishonesty and living with it the best we can, or we can begin the effort to change the way we think and live. The disease of the modern character is specialization. Looked at from the standpoint of the social system, the aim of specialization may seem desirable enough. The aim is to see that the responsibilities of government, law, medicine, engineering, agriculture, education, etc., are given into the hands of the most skilled, best prepared people. The difficulties do not appear until we look at specialization from the opposite standpoint, that of individual persons. We then begin to see the grotesquerie, indeed the impossibility, of an idea of community wholeness that divorces itself from any idea of personal wholeness. The first and best known hazard of the specialist system is that it produces specialists, people who are elaborately and expensively trained to do one thing. We get into absurdity very quickly here. There are, for instance, educators who have nothing to teach, communicators who have nothing to say, medical doctors skilled at expensive cures for diseases that they have no skill and no interest in preventing. More common and more damaging are the inventors, manufacturers, and salesmen of devices who have no concern for the possible effects of those devices. Specialization is thus seen to be a way of institutionalizing, justifying, and paying highly for a calamitous disintegration and scattering out of the various functions of character. Workmanship, care, conscience, responsibility. Even worse, a system of specialization requires the abdication to specialists of various competences and responsibilities that were once personal and universal. Thus, the average, one is tempted to say the ideal, American citizen now consigns the problem of food production to agriculturists and agribusinessmen, the problems of health to doctors and sanitation experts, the problems of education to school teachers and educators, the problems of conservation to conservationists, and so on. This supposedly fortunate citizen is therefore left with only two concerns: making money and entertaining himself. He earns money typically as a specialist, working an 8-hour day at a job for the quality or consequences of which somebody else, or perhaps more typically nobody else, will be responsible. And, not surprisingly, since he can do so little else for himself, he is even unable to entertain himself, for there exists an enormous industry of exorbitantly expensive specialists whose purpose is to entertain him. The beneficiary of this regime of specialists ought to be the happiest of mortals, or so we are expected to believe. All of his vital concerns are in the hands of certified experts. He is a certified expert himself, and as such, he earns more money in a year than all his great-grandparents put together. Between stints at his job, he has nothing to do but mow his lawn with a sit-down lawnmower or watch other certified experts on television. At supper time, he may eat a tray of ready-prepared food, which he and his wife, also a certified expert, procure at the cost only of money, transportation, and the pushing of a button. For a few minutes between supper and sleep, he may catch a glimpse of his children, who, since breakfast, have been in the care of education experts, basketball or marching band experts, or perhaps legal experts. The fact is, however, that this is probably the most unhappy average citizen in the history of the world. He has not the power to provide himself with anything but money, and his money is inflating like a balloon and drifting away, subject to historical circumstances and the power of other people. From morning to night, he does not touch anything that he has produced himself, in which he can take pride. For all his leisure and recreation, he feels bad. He looks bad. He is overweight. His health is poor. His air, water, and food are all known to contain poisons. There is a fair chance that he will die of suffocation. He suspects that his love life is not as fulfilling as other people's. He wishes that he had been born sooner or later. He does not know why his children are the way they are. He does not understand what they say. He does not care much and does not know why he does not care. He does not know what his wife wants or what he wants. Certain advertisements and pictures in magazines make him suspect that he is basically unattractive. He feels that all his possessions are under threat of pillage. He does not know what he would do if he lost his job, if the economy failed, if the utility companies failed, if the police went on strike, if the truckers went on strike, if his wife left him, if his children ran away, if he should be found to be incurably ill. And for these anxieties, of course, he consults certified experts, who in turn consult certified experts about their anxieties. It is rarely considered that this average citizen is anxious because he ought to be, because he still has some gumption that he has not yet given up in deference to the experts. He ought to be anxious because he is helpless, that he is dependent upon so many specialists, the beneficiary of so much expert help, can only mean that he is a captive, a potential victim. If he lives by the competence of so many other people, then he lives also by their indulgence. His own will and his own reasons to live are made subordinate to the mere tolerance of everybody else. He has one chance to live what he conceives to be his life, his own small specialty within a delicate, tense, everywhere strained system of specialties. From a public point of view, the specialist system is a failure, because though everything is done by an expert, very little is done well. Our typical industrial or professional product is both ingenious and shoddy. The specialist system fails from a personal point of view because a person who can only do one thing can do virtually nothing for himself. In living in the world by his own will and skill, The stupidest peasant or tribesman is more competent than the most intelligent worker or technician or intellectual in a society of specialists. What happens under the rule of specialization is that, though society becomes more and more intricate, it has less and less structure. It becomes more and more organized, but less and less orderly. The community disintegrates because it loses the necessary understandings, forms, and enactments of the relations among materials and processes, principles and actions, ideals and realities, past and present, present and future, men and women, body and spirit, city and country, civilization and wilderness, growth and decay, life and death, just as the individual character loses the sense of a responsible involvement in these relations. No longer does human life rise from the earth like a pyramid, broadly and considerately founded upon its sources. Now it scatters itself out in a reckless horizontal sprawl, like a disorderly city whose suburbs and pavements destroy the fields. The concept of country, homeland, dwelling place becomes simplified as the environment, that is, what surrounds us. Once we see our place, our part of the world, as surrounding us, we have already made a profound division between it and ourselves. We have given up the understanding, dropped it out of our language and so out of our thought, that we and our country create one another, depend on one another, are literally part of one another. That our land passes in and out of our bodies just as our bodies pass in and out of our land. That as we and our land are part of one another, so all who are living as neighbors here, human and plant and animal, are part of one another, and so cannot possibly flourish alone. That, therefore, our culture must be our response to our place. Our culture and our place are images of each other and inseparable from each other, and so neither can be better than the other. Because, by definition, they lack any such sense of mutuality or wholeness, our specializations subsist on conflict with one another. The rule is never to cooperate, but rather to follow one's own interest as far as possible. Checks and balances are all applied externally, by opposition, never by self-restraint. Labor, management, the military, the government, etc., never forbear until their excesses arouse enough opposition to force them to do so. The good of the whole of creation, the world and all its creatures together, is never a consideration because it is never thought of. Our culture now simply lacks the means for thinking of it. It is for this reason that none of our basic problems is ever solved. Indeed, it is for this reason that our basic problems are getting worse. The specialists are profiting too well from the symptoms, evidently, to be concerned about cures. Just as the myth of imminent cure, by some breakthrough of science or technology, is so lucrative and all-justifying as to foreclose any possibility of an interest in prevention. The problems thus have become the stock in trade of specialists. The so-called professions survive by endlessly processing and talking about problems that they have neither the will nor the competence to solve. The doctor who is interested in disease but not in health is clearly in the same category with the conservationist who invests in the destruction of what he otherwise intends to preserve. They both have the comfort of job security, but at the cost of ultimate futility. One of the most troubling characteristics of the specialist mentality is its use of money as a kind of proxy. Its willingness to transmute the powers and functions of life into money. Time is money is one of its axioms and the source of many evils, among them the waste of both time and money. Akin to the idea that time is money is the concept, less spoken but as commonly assumed, that we may be adequately represented by money. The giving of money has thus become our characteristic virtue. But to give is not to do. The money is given in lieu of action, thought, care, time. And it is no remedy for the fragmentation of character and consciousness that is the consequence of specialization. At the simplest, most practical level, it would be difficult for most of us to give enough in donations to good causes to compensate for, much less remedy, the damage done by the money that is taken from us and used destructively by various agencies of the government and by the corporations that hold us in captive dependence on their products. More important, even if we could give enough to overbalance the official and corporate misuse of our money, we would still not solve the problem. The willingness to be represented by money involves a submission to the modern divisions of character and community. The remedy safeguards the disease. This has become, to some extent at least, an argument against institutional solutions. Such solutions necessarily fail to solve the problems to which they are addressed because, by definition, they cannot consider the real causes. The only real, practical, hope-giving way to remedy the fragmentation that is the disease of the modern spirit is a small and humble way. A way that a government or agency or organization or institution will never think of, though a person may think of it. One must begin in one's own life the private solutions that can only in turn become public solutions. If, for instance, one is aware of the abuses and extortions to which one is subjected as a modern consumer, then one may join an organization of consumers to lobby for consumer protection legislation. But in joining a consumer organization, one defines oneself as a consumer merely, and a mere consumer is by definition a dependent, at the mercy of the manufacturer and the salesman. If the organization secures the desired legislation, then the consumer becomes the dependent not only of the manufacturer and salesman, but of the agency that enforces the law, and is at its mercy as well. The law enacted may be a good one, and the enforcers all honest and effective. Even so, the consumer will understand that one result of his effort has been to increase the number of people of whom he must beware. The consumer may proceed to organization and even to legislation by considering only his rights. And most of the recent talk about consumer protection has had to do with the consumer's rights. Very little indeed has been said about the consumer's responsibilities. It may be that whereas one's rights may be advocated and even served by an organization, one's responsibilities cannot. It may be that when one hands one's responsibilities to an organization, one becomes, by that divestiture, irresponsible. It may be that responsibility is intransigently a personal matter, that a responsibility can be fulfilled or failed, but cannot be got rid of. If a consumer begins to think and act in consideration of his responsibilities, then he vastly increases his capacities as a person, and he begins to be effective in a different way. A way that is smaller, perhaps, and certainly less dramatic, but sounder, and able sooner or later to assume the force of example. A responsible consumer would be a critical consumer, would refuse to purchase the less good. And he would be a moderate consumer. He would know his needs and would not purchase what he did not need. He would sort among his needs and study to reduce them. These things, of course, have been often said, though in our time they have not been said very loudly and have not been much heeded. In our time, the rule among consumers has been to spend money recklessly. People whose governing habit is the relinquishment of power, competence, and responsibility, and whose characteristic suffering is the anxiety of futility, make excellent spenders. They are the ideal consumers. By inducing in them little panics of boredom, powerlessness, sexual failure, mortality, paranoia, they can be made to buy or vote for virtually anything that is attractively packaged. The advertising industry is founded upon this principle. What has not been often said, because it did not need to be said until fairly recent times, is that the responsible consumer must also be in some way a producer. Out of his own resources and skills, he must be equal to some of his own needs. The household that prepares its own meals in its own kitchen with some intelligent regard for nutritional value, and thus depends on the grocer only for selected raw materials, exercises an influence on the food industry that reaches from the store all the way back to the seedsman. The household that produces some or all of its own food will have a proportionately greater influence. The household that can provide some of its own pleasures will not be helplessly dependent on the entertainment industry, will influence it by not being helplessly dependent on it, and will not support it thoughtlessly out of boredom.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.